Bundy.
Los Angeles Police calling all cars, attention all cars, broadcast 187 regarding a burglary and murder. Suspect described as male American, about 6 feet tall. Has a butterfly tattooed on his left arm. That's all. Rosenquist.
Vacation, I'm going to do two things I've wanted to do for a long time. I'm going to hear Calling All Cars just as you hear it, and I'm going to have time to try and find out for myself why people buy certain brands of gasoline. I cannot believe the saying that ignorance is bliss, yet when even the worst gasoline the law permits to be sold claims faster pickup, more mileage, greater power, and motorists pay good money for it, ignorance must be bliss. There are just as many grades of gasoline as there are grades of food, cosmetics, clothes, or anything else we buy. There are many poor grades of gasoline. There are many good gasolines and a few best gasolines. Of these few best gasolines, what definite tangible proof, what authentic fact is given you as a guide to your gasoline purchase? Rio Grande extends to you a cordial invitation to buy based on the fact that those who buy the most gasoline and those to whom the finest gasoline is an absolute necessity have overwhelmingly chosen Rio Grande Cracked. When you buy Rio Grande Cracked gasoline, no guesswork is involved. Oakland and Los Angeles, for example, the two largest users of gasoline in California, have specified Rio Grande Cracked gasoline for years and have just renewed these contracts. Over 30 other cities and counties have selected Rio Grande Crack as the finest gasoline obtainable to power their police cars, fire engines, ambulances, and other emergency equipment. Let these facts guide you to your independent Rio Grande dealer tomorrow. Now it is our privilege to present Mr. Harry S. Seeger, Deputy Chief of the Los Angeles Police Department. Chief Seeger.
Crime in any form has consistently been shown on this program as a losing proposition. The case we are to hear tonight is no exception. There are many aspects to the situation which, of necessity, must be left untouched, not because of any fear of reprisal, but because the element of time prevents their being treated fully. This case is particularly interesting for the lesson it teaches regarding bad association. One of the principals in the story probably never would have come in contact with the police except for this association. I see that our production is ready, so I'll save a few highlights for the end of the program.
In a little cottage on a secluded street in San Diego, a young girl stands watching from a window. Her mother is busy preparing dinner.
You won't come any quicker, dear, for your watching.
I know, Mother.
Oh, I wish you weren't so in love with Tom, Mary. It frightens me a little.
Why, Mother, I do believe you're being an old lady.
Well, just wait until you have a daughter of your own, young woman. You'll see what I mean then.
I know what you mean, darling. But I know you're wrong about Tom.
Well, I'm not so sure about that. Oh, I wish I was as proud of him as you are.
Mother, is it because Tom's a sailor that you don't like him?
Oh, Lord, no, child. Why, some of the best lads I ever knew were sailors. Now, there's nothing wrong about being a sailor.
Well, then just why have you taken such a dislike to Tom?
As a matter of fact, dear, I don't dislike him. But there's something about that boy that makes me feel uneasy when he's around you.
Why, Mother, what could it be?
Oh, he seems to look at you with such a, well, such a possessive look.
Oh, well, what's wrong with that? Tomorrow I'll be his wife. Hasn't he a right to look at me the way, that way he wants to?
That's not what I mean. He... Oh, never mind. You go on watching for him. I've got to base the rope.
I think... Yes, I see him. He's coming, Mother.
Well, for land's sake, stop yelling about it. Open the door. Maybe he'll find his way in.
Tom.
Hello, Gidlet.
Oh, it's good to see you again.
How have you been, huh?
Well, darling. You?
Couldn't be better. How's your mom?
Couldn't be better. Oh, Mother, Tom's here.
So I guess. Well, come in, you two. Don't stand there with the door open. The fog are coming in. Come on in, Tom.
Okay. Well, how's Mother, huh?
Not Mother till tomorrow, young man.
Gee, I've been anxious to get back. I've been transferred to the Arizona, you know.
No. When?
This morning. We're shoving off for Pedro tomorrow night.
Oh.
Now, don't you worry, Kidlet. You'll be all right. Irene will take care of you.
Irene?
Yeah. She's a gal I know in L.A. She and you can live together while I'm at sea.
Who is she?
Oh, she's a kid used to live down here. Married a pal of mine, but they couldn't make a go of it. He fell for some other dame, so she divorced him. She lives in a place on Bonnie Bray in L.A. She'll be glad to have you.
But, Tom, I'd rather...
Nonsense. We'll get married tomorrow. You go on up to L.A., I'll be in by day after tomorrow, and we're all set. I've got a week's leave. We'll have the time of our lives.
Well, if you want me to...
Sure. We'll be all right.
Come and get it, or I'll throw it out.
That's the way I like it. Come and get it. Oh, boy, does that roast smell good.
Then start carving it.
Well, here we go. Just a little cut up. That's me. Well, here you are, Mary. Now, gravy.
On in the other room. I want to get this mess cleaned up.
I'll help you, Mother.
No, you'll do nothing of the kind. Go on in there with Tom.
Oh, no, Mother. I won't.
Go on. Get out of here.
Well, call me when they're ready to dry.
Oh, man. If you can only cook like your mother.
I get it. Roast like my mother used to make, eh?
Come on, sit down. Here. Close. Gee, I love you, Kitty.
I love you, too, Tom.
Your lips seem softer every time I kiss you.
That's your imagination, isn't it?
No, it's not. I love you, Kate.
Tom, please.
What's the matter, Kate?
Oh, nothing. You were holding me too tight. I couldn't breathe.
I'd like to hold you so tight you could never get away. Your mind.
Please, Tom. You better go now. It's late. I've got to help Mother clean up the kitchen.
Okay, kid. I'll shove off. You're tired. You got to be fresh as a daisy in the morning. Well, I'll be seeing you.
Goodbye, darling.
How's that, kid?
That's better. Now run along. I've got to help Mother.
Okay. Night.
Good night, darling. Good night. Good night, Tom.
Has Tom gone, Mary?
Yes, Mother. I'll be right out.
Next day, Mary heard a justice of the peace say, I now pronounce you husband and wife. Blinded by love, she did not see the glint in the hard eyes of her new husband, a glint of unwarranted possession. Tom and Mary began their new life in a tiny apartment shared by the girl, Irene. Tom spent most of his days with Mary, his evenings somewhere else. He had no job, but he made excuses for his absences. But Mary didn't worry about it. She was too busy making a home. Then, one day, when Tom was away, Irene came home.
Oh, hello, kid. Where's Tom?
I don't know. He went out about an hour ago. Said he'd be right back.
Anybody call while I was out?
Nobody but a Jack Redmond. He wanted Tom.
Who's he?
I don't know. Some fellow Tom met the other night when we were all down at Solomon.
Did you meet him?
No. Tom said he was a fellow he knew in the Navy.
By the way, when does Tom's ship sail?
Why, I don't know. I didn't ask him. I'd forgotten all about it.
Mm-hmm. Boy, he must draw down a lot of pay to be able to stay ashore all the time.
Oh, Tom, we were beginning to worry about you.
Where have you been keeping yourself, big boy?
All around. Anybody call?
Jack Redmond. He...
Did he leave any message?
He said tell you he'd see you tonight at the drugstore.
What time?
He said the usual time.
Who is this bird, Tom?
A friend of mine. We've been on a few jobs together.
Jobs?
Yeah. Jobs.
Oh, Tom, I didn't know you had a job.
I haven't.
If you'll excuse me, I'll take a walk somewhere.
Well, what's wrong, Irene? You've only just come in.
Oh, well, I've still got to go down to the corner and get some cigarettes, and I'll be right back.
That's funny. I wonder what's the matter with her.
Nothing's the matter with her. He'll be back in a few minutes.
Tom, tell me about your job.
I didn't say I had a job.
But I thought you just
said... I said job. You know, job.
But what kind of job?
For the love of Mike, if I got to draw you a picture of it, housebreaking job, stick-ups, that sort of stuff.
Oh.
What's the matter with you?
You hold up people? Rob them?
Sure, why not? They got Jack, I ain't. So what? So I go into their dumps and I get what I want.
Well, but I
thought... You thought we could live on $60 a month I get on the ship. Sure we could, but who wants it? I want real dough. I don't want no chicken feed like that. Jack and I got a job lined up that'll put us on Easy Street. We've got to have a little capital. So we're pulling another job tonight.
I married a thief and a robber.
What's that?
You're a thief.
So what? You want to stick with me or you want to shove off?
Oh, Tom. How can you stand there and be so cold about it?
Huh?
Don't you realize what this does to us? Don't you realize that this kills everything between us? Don't you see I can't go on being your wife? Always wondering whether you're coming home alone or whether you're going to be brought home in an ambulance?
Cut it.
Tom, promise me you won't go tonight. Promise.
Ah, what's easier? Nothing's going to happen to me.
Tom, you've got to promise.
What do you think I am, a baby? Why don't you come along to hold my hand?
That's just what I will do.
You'll do what?
I'll go with you.
Have you gone nuts?
No.
Then what the devil's the matter with you?
Nothing.
You mean we'll team up? You'll work these jobs with me?
Yes. Why not?
You mean that?
Yes, I mean it.
Well, let's scram. Like a fine idea. Hey, Mary, where did you put that automatic of mine?
You aren't going to take it with you, are you?
What? Hey, have you gone batty sure enough? Of course I'm going to take it. Where is it?
In the top dresser drawer.
Thanks. Hey. Hey, what's that you're putting in your purse?
My gun.
That pop gun? You couldn't kill a fly with that.
It might serve its purpose.
Well, if it'll make you feel any better, take it along.
Tom, you wouldn't shoot a man, would you?
What do you think I'm toting this rod for? To play tiddlywinks?
I just wonder.
Now, come on. Come on. Snap out of it.
Oh, is the battle over, little mother?
Well, come on in, Irene. We're going out for a little while.
What's up?
Nothing at all, lady. We got an appointment to see a gentleman about a canine.
Oh, well, you'll have one with a district attorney if you don't shove that gat father down in your pocket.
Huh? Oh, thanks, sister. Well?
We'll be seeing you.
I'm afraid.
An hour later, Tom and Mary alighted from a streetcar at 8th and Irola. They made their way cautiously to a house near the middle of the block. Unaware of the presence of persons living in the house, they stopped to discuss their plans.
Please, Tom, let's go back. I'm afraid.
No, I'm not. You said you'd come with me if I'd make this the last job. Well, I promised, didn't I?
Yes, I know you did. But I'm afraid.
Oh, nothing's going to happen, and if it does, I can take care of it. Now, look, you go around to the side of the house. I'll sneak around and try the side door. If I get in, you keep a lookout. If anybody comes, yell like the devil.
All right.
Come on, what are you doing? There's people in this house.
What are we going to do?
We'll try this place next door. It's like no one's home. You go on out the backyard and watch. I'll climb in this window.
Tom! Tom! Tom!
What the devil's the matter with you? Pipe down. You want every cop in Los Angeles down here on a net?
Tom, there's somebody moving around in the house next door. I saw a man using the phone. The lights are all on.
Come on in here and start shooting off your mouth.
I heard a car stop in front.
Probably cops.
Look! There's a man with a flashlight.
Come on, let's go.
Mary is taken to the prison ward of the county hospital. A dragnet is thrown about the district where the crime was committed. But evidently, Foley had made good his escape. Officers are dispatched to the waterfront to watch outgoing vessels. The Navy Shore Patrol is called in. Every available man is on the lookout for Tom Foley. Meanwhile, in the hospital, Mary is being questioned by Deputy District Attorney William Clark.
Now, we just want to get at the truth about this. If you're innocent, you have nothing to fear.
Shouldn't I have a lawyer?
Yes, I suppose you should, if you want to. But even though anything you say may be used against you, on the other hand, anything you say in your favor, I'll use for you.
What do you want to know?
You're married?
Yes.
How long have you been married?
About 2 weeks.
What is your husband's name?
Tom Foley.
What does he do for a living?
He's a sailor.
What ship?
The Arizona.
How long since he's been aboard his ship?
I don't know.
Has he deserted his ship?
I don't know.
Was your husband with you tonight?
Yes.
How did you happen to go to that house?
I went with Tom.
Did he compel you to go?
No.
You went of your own accord?
Yes.
Why?
He promised to stop.
Yes, to stop.
He promised to stop breaking into places if I go with him.
And you believed him?
Yes.
Do you still love your husband?
Yes.
Even though he ran away and left you to face the police?
I'll always love him.
Why did you have a gun?
I meant to kill myself.
Why?
I knew that everything was over between Tom and me.
Yet you went with him.
Yes. I didn't want anything to happen to him.
He didn't seem to care if something happened to you.
He didn't mean to run away.
Mrs. Foley, if it's any comfort to you, I want to tell you that you cannot be compelled to testify against your husband.
Oh, I'm glad. Please don't ask me any more questions. Please don't.
Well, Mr. Clark, I caught Foley. I'm bringing him down to headquarters right away.
Tell them I'll be right down.
Yes, sir.
Well, Mrs. Foley, it looks like the end for your husband. Well, Foley, you seem to have been in a hurry to leave town. Where were you going?
Frisco.
Isn't your ship in San Pedro?
Yes. But if I reported in Frisco, it would have been all right.
Then you weren't deserting?
No.
What do you call absenting yourself from your ship for the length of time you've been gone without reporting aboard?
I wasn't deserting.
Why did you run away and leave your wife last night?
Figured I could do her more good out than if I was in jail.
It didn't occur to you that you were being rather cowardly?
No. I figured I could help her if I was out.
You didn't think you might help her if you stayed there?
I didn't think about it.
Why did you kill that officer?
I didn't kill anybody. It was Jack.
Who's Jack?
Jack Redmond.
Where does this Redmond live?
I don't know.
Where do you meet him when you plan these jobs of yours?
It's Solomon's dance hall.
Check Solomon's on that officer.
Yes, sir.
You say Redmond fired the shot that killed McGee?
Yeah.
Did you have a gun at the time?
No.
Your wife says you did.
Then she's telling a deliberate lie.
Joe, bring Mrs. Foley in here.
You can't get away with this.
That's what you say. Sit down, Mrs. Foley.
Thank you.
Now, Mrs. Foley, did you see any other man with your husband last night?
No, sir.
Did your husband have a gun?
Yes.
What kind?
An automatic.
A large one or a small one?
A large one.
That's a lie. I never had a gun.
Oh, Tom.
Officer, bring in that Irene woman.
Yes, sir.
You didn't know we'd picked her up, did you, Foley?
What difference does that make?
Here she is, Mr. Clark.
Irene? Tom here claims he never owned a gun. Is that true?
How should I know?
Didn't you see him take a gun with him when he left his apartment last night?
Your guess is as good as mine.
How'd you like to be locked up as a material witness in this case?
You can't do that to me.
That's what you think. Take her out of here. Lock her up till she's ready to talk.
Wait a minute. Sure, he had a gun. I saw it all right. It was an automatic. Now can I go? Can I?
Go on, get her out of here. It might interest you to know, Foley, that six of your shipmates from the Arizona say that you told them you intended deserting, going into the business of holding up people and robbing homes.
That's a lie, too.
They also testify that you owned a .45 automatic stolen from the Arizona.
That's a lie.
You know that a .45 bullet killed McGee?
I don't know anything about it.
That the bullet shows evidence of having been issued from government stores.
So what?
And that bullet was fired from your gun.
Well, you'll have to prove that.
We intend to. What did you do with that gun?
I sold it.
Where?
To a fellow in Long Beach.
I thought you didn't own a gun.
Well, that was before I...
Go on. Before what?
I ain't talking.
Oh, yes, you are.
I don't have to.
You claim that Jack Redmond fired those shots last night and killed Officer McGee.
Yes.
Then why don't you tell us where we can find this Redmond?
I don't know where he is.
I
checked up Solomon Stan's home, Mr. Clark, and he says he never heard of a Jack Redmond.
Hmm. That's what I expected. Thanks, officer. Well, police?
Well, what?
Have you anything to say to that?
I ain't talking no more.
I think you've said enough to convince the district attorney that you're indictable for murder.
No. No, you can't get away with that. I didn't do it, I tell you. It was Jack Redmond. He did it. I saw him. He shot Maggie. You can't pin this on me.
We're not trying to pin anything on you, Foley. But so far, you've refused to help either us or yourself. You say some man named Redmond killed McGee. Yet you haven't convinced us that this Redmond even exists. You've been yellow throughout this whole affair. We'll hold you, Foley.
The man who deserted his wife and left her to face the guns of the police was held. And 3 months later, he stood before the bar of justice and heard...
Tom Foley has been found guilty as charged. I sentence you, therefore, to not less than 5 years, no more than life, for the crime of burglary. For the crime of murder committed while attempting burglary, I sentence you to prison for the remainder of your natural life.
No. No, I didn't do it. I didn't do it, I tell you.